got to trust in it. Old folks, you say, hold to God's unchanging hand. Build your hopes on things eternal. Just hold to God's unchanging hands. Amen. We thank God for all that is said and done. We thank the Lord for his mighty hand. And we know that the teaching for this month of June, I'm sorry, April. We jumped to June already. For the month of April, we're going to be focusing on the book of John. And I told the Sunday school this morning that the book of John is so powerful. It's powerful because John had a relationship with Jesus like none of the other disciples. And when you have a relationship with the Lord, it ain't like anybody else's. Do I have a witness this morning? And I believe that if you would just come to him in your own way, if we would seek the Lord, the Bible says, while he may be found, and we can call on him while he's near, and he will see about us. I want to come to you this morning with not a lot of scripture. We're going to try to keep it short. So short that I only focus on two verses this morning. Somebody say, thank you, Pastor. Amen. We're going to be coming from the book of John, chapter 1. Verses 1 through 2. We thank God for Reverend Blanks reading the scripture. We thank God for Reverend Edie with that heartfelt prayer. And we pray the Holy Spirit do something with that ponytail. Amen. But I'm just going to read for you this morning John 1, verse 1. Very familiar scripture. But as I studied just these two, God just unpacked so much.
All right.
And if you're able to stand, we ask you to stand for the reading of God's word. We're only going to read one verse, because that's all that we need. John 1, verse 1, and it reads, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. You may be seated in his presence. Let us look to the Lord in prayer. Father God, we thank you for your holy and righteous word. God, we thank you for the opportunity to break the bread of life, God. Lord, thank you for using me, your manservant,
Jesus,
to serve these thine people, God.
Yes.
God, thank you for giving us a servant heart, a servant mind, and a servant spirit.
Yes,
Lord, we want to be more like you. But in order for us to be like you, we have to be in you.
Amen.
But you said in your word that if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. Behold, all things have passed away. Behold, all things become new. So God, give us a rhema word this morning. God, give us a new word this morning. God, give us a word that we've never heard before. God, prick us in our hearts, and we'll forever give your name the praise. In Jesus' mighty name. Amen.
Amen.
I want you to look to your neighbor this morning and repeat after me. Say, neighbor,
neighbor,
old neighbor,
old neighbor,
start out,
start out
with the word,
with the word,
start out with the word. John's gospel is teaching us this morning, church, that everything that's good, whether it's our possessions, whether it's our thoughts, whether it's our husbands, whether it is our wives, every good and perfect thing comes from the Lord. Do I have a witness this morning? I want to share to you something with you, something that happened some years ago with me. And Natalie and I had the distinct privilege to stay at the JW Marriott in Los Angeles, California. No, I didn't spend that money. We won that trip. Somebody help me. Because I'm tight on a dollar. You can ask First Lady Smith that. But we had the opportunity to go to American Idol. And I think that was the year that Scotty McCrory was won American Idol that year. And it was a good trip. We were there for 3 days and I think 2 nights. We had a great time. They even gave us $500 to spend. I said, praise the Lord. I can spend money and I ain't got to come out my pocket. Praise the Lord. But we ate at the restaurant that morning. The restaurant in the JW Marriott. And when you're around rich folk, you make you feel like you're somebody. Hold your head up. Stick your chest out. Knowing you got $500 in your pocket. Come on, somebody. But we were eating at the restaurant that morning and we were eating the pancakes. And those had to be some of the second best pancakes I've ever eaten. Because the first best pancakes is cooked by that lady over there. I ain't lost all my little mind. Come on, somebody. But we were eating the pancakes and the lady brought me a cup of coffee. Now, church, I like some coffee. When I tell you I like some coffee, I'm a little funky about my coffee. That lady brought some coffee. When I smelled it, I knew it was special. Y'all not hear what I'm saying? And normally people like the smell of coffee. But when I drunk that coffee, let me tell y'all something. I felt like somebody stuck another $500 in my pocket. That coffee made me feel like I was somebody. That was some good coffee. It was some good. And the lady said, "Sir, would you like another cup of coffee? I got a problem." I said, "Yes, I will." I share that with you because the coffee was good and it was just, it throughout the whole day, church, I'm telling you, the whole day I was thinking about that coffee. When I got back home from the trip, I went to work. I said, "Have y'all ever heard of this type of coffee?" They hadn't never heard of it. I just got that much taller because I had indulged in something that nobody else had ever heard about. I even went to the grocery store. I was telling the folk in the grocery store, "Y'all need to get some of this coffee." But they don't sell it in the grocery store. You have to order. It's gourmet coffee. And I stopped by to tell somebody this morning.
Yeah,
God can do some things in your life that no other man can do, that no other woman can do. And when he puts it in your spirit, you don't mind telling somebody about the goodness of the Lord. Do I have a witness in the building? There's some stuff that God has given you in your life that when you go to somebody, you know that somebody didn't get the same thing you got. Oh, I wish I had a church this morning. He will do exceeding abundantly all that we could ever ask or think. The songwriter said, "I wasn't going to tell nobody, but I couldn't keep it to myself. What the Lord has done for me." And I wish I had some folk in the building that God has done some mighty things in your life. He put a taste in your mouth that nobody can put. He put a running in your step that you didn't have in the Jew joint. I wish I had a church this morning. I wish I had somebody knew that God had done some stuff in your life. But it started in the beginning. Tell somebody, you got to start out. You got to start out with the Word. All of us has had an experience with the Lord that we've never had in anything else. And while I was talking about coffee this morning, some of you have had some things that happened in your life that it was so good, it was beyond explanation. All right. God has done some things in your life that it doesn't make human sense, but it makes heavenly sense. Right. Do I have a witness this morning? Some of you might have been in the hospital, and the x-ray came out and it looked mighty bad. But the next day the doctor took the x-ray again. And for whatever reason, God took whatever was in the x-ray yesterday and put a praise on the inside. I wish I had helped somebody. Somebody had cancer on yesterday's x-ray. But God came in and put a hallelujah where the x-ray couldn't find the cancer. Do I have anybody in here? God has done some mighty things in your life. Did God take some pain out of your body? Has God taken some stuff out of your relationship? Has God put some money in the bank? Oh, I wish I had some help this morning. Is there anybody in here? God has done some mighty things in your life. And he'll do it to the point that you can't even forget about it. I want to talk about the famous black author, Ralph Ellison. He quoted, when it came down to writing down the things God had put in the inside of him, he said, "Without the possibility of action, all knowledge comes to one foul labor, foul and forget. Do I have a witness? And I can either foul it or I can forget it. In other words, God can do some stuff in your life that you don't want to forget. But there's some stuff that man would do in your life you wish you could forget. Can I help you this morning? Can I walk down your street this morning? There's some relationships you had you don't want to put in the foul. Y'all help me this morning. You want to put it in the forget trash can. Somebody was treating you wrong, and you don't want to remember that. You don't want to put it in the file. You want to put it in the forget. But I know that God has blessed somebody in this church. He's brought you out of darkness, and he puts you in the marvelous light. Do I have a witness this morning? There's a mother in this church. You had bills that were due, and you didn't know how you were going to make it. But God somehow, every time you scoop down in the barrel, or I'm trying to help somebody, there was more than enough to feed your babies. Do I have anybody in the church that know that God did some stuff that you don't want to forget? Look at somebody and say, I don't want to forget. This brings us to the book of John. The book of John has done some powerful things to the reader. Because John has done something that the other three gospels, the other three synoptic gospels, doesn't have. Can I share that with you? You see, John had written a number of words in the book of John that you won't find the number of occurrences in any of the synoptic gospels. We see the words that talk about signs and miracles show up 21 times in John's gospel. We see the word love appear in John's gospel 57 times.
All right.
More than any time in the other three gospels from Matthew, Mark, and Luke. But more interestingly, we find the word believe in John's gospel, get this church, 99 times.
All right.
Nowhere in the synoptics do you find someone calling on the reader to believe on the Lord Jesus more than the book of John. Do I have a witness this morning? John makes it so that when he writes the word, that it doesn't just show up one time. That when I'm reading the book of John, I can find love more than one time. If I look in the book of John, I can find miracles more than one time. Do I have a witness this morning? But the one thing I want to highlight to you this morning, that the evangelistic power of the book of John calls us to believe. Touch somebody and say, you need to believe. John understands the power of God's word. John's gospel also sets itself aside because he does not use the earthly elements to convince us to believe on the Lord. He doesn't go into a long diatribe of his ecclesiastical power. He does not go down the lineage talking about who his daddy was, who his granddaddy was, and who his grandma was. He doesn't set up the story of how it took a man, Mary and Joseph, to ride on a donkey in Luke 1 when we were hearing about the birth story.
All right.
John does something that is different than any of the other three gospels, the way it's presented.
Yes, sir.
God opens us to see what John is showing us. And he shows us that he opens up the book by talking about the Lord.
Yes.
Do I have a witness this morning?
Come on now.
John's gospel doesn't use a lot of words. God just uses the word in the book of John. Do I have a witness this morning? As Christians, we ought not be ashamed to just simply stand on the word of God. We don't have to prove anything in the church. All we have to do is stand on the word of God. Do I have a witness this morning? We need to be able to hold fast on God's power and his existence simply in his mighty word. Because God's word we find in John 1 and 1. John's word is able to create some stuff when there's nothing there. I wish I had some help this morning. God's word has the ability to tear down but build back up something that can be used for his glory. God's word has the ability to magnify himself in your life. We'll have a church this morning. God's word has the ability to bring worship out of us when we got pain on the inside of our bodies. God's word has the ability when we think about the works that we may have done on the world, good God Almighty. But I wish I had somebody in the church that knew that God's word changed your life. Somebody know that God's word changed your sickness to joy. Somebody know that God's word brought your husband and your wife back home. I know I'm getting close to somebody's house. God's word was able to bring water to a dry land. Somebody need to add the Israelites. Every time they got hungry, God's word rained down manna and quail. I wish I had some help this morning. I remember reading the word that when we needed something, God said he had cattle on 1,000 hills. And if I look on the word, I can find everything that I need in God's word. Do I have somebody in the building to know that on the inside of God's word, he can give us everything, everything that we need? But we got to use his word to get what we need. Somebody say yeah. Somebody say yeah. But we got to start out. We got to start out with the word. We can't start out with our flesh. We can't start out with our emotions. We can't start out with our desolate situation. But we got to see what God's word says in the beginning. I want to give y'all a little something, and then we're going to get on out of here. Verse 1, I'm just going to give you a little bit of verse 1. Matter of fact, I'm not going to preach anymore except for verse 1. Somebody say thank you, Pastor. Verse 1 of John 1 and 1 says, in the beginning was the word.
Yes.
I'm going to stop right there. Mm-hmm. I'm going to give this to you. You can take it on back to the house and chew on it. Mm-hmm. Let God's word set things in motion. Mm-hmm.
All right.
Let me say that again. Let God's word set things in motion. Have you ever tried to convince somebody that the goodness of the Lord that you experience came from nobody but the Lord? There are some people that if you tell them what God has done for you, they'll find some ulterior reason why you were blessed. You went to the doctor, and somehow the sickness has gone away. But somebody that is standing on the side says, well, I remember you were taking those pills. Maybe it was the pills that made you feel better. I wish I had some help this morning. Or maybe when you didn't have money in your pocket, and you had more bills than money. As they say, you had more month than money. You look down at the gas hand, and the gas hand wasn't saying empty. It was saying emergency. Y'all don't want to help me this morning. But it seemed like every time you got in your car, God still allowed it to happen. But then somebody said, well, you know, when you on E, you got 5 gallons still in the tank. But you need to look them in the face and let them know I've been running on them 5 gallons for the past 3 days. Y'all want to help me this morning. Every time I turn the key, I got enough gas to get me to work. I wish I had some help this morning. I got enough gas to get me to the house. I got enough gas to pick up my kids. I got enough gas to get to the grocery store. I got enough gas to pick my mom from the hospital. Do I have anybody in the building? The word is all you need. The word is all you need. Somebody say yes.
Yes.
In the beginning was the word.
Yes.
In the beginning was the word. John tells us, I don't need to prove anybody about Jesus. God tells us, I don't need to tell you what he did when he was a little boy. He tells us in his word, I don't have to go back to Mary and Joseph. I don't have to go back to the earthly beginning.
Yeah,
but I got to take you back to the heavenly beginning.
Yeah.
I wish I had some help this morning.
Right.
Sometime we got to go back to where it all started.
Yeah.
Y'all walk with me this morning.
Yeah.
God uses the word when he says the beginning was the word.
Yeah.
I had to go back and study the Greek word. Can I help y'all teach this thing for a little bit? You see, the Greek word for word is logos.
Yes.
You got to understand what logos means and why John used it in this context.
Yes.
Because you see, John understood a little bit about Greek mythology, but he also understood Aristotelian logic.
Yes.
I'm trying to get y'all deep in this thing.
Right.
We can't be scratching the surface no more.
Right.
We can't be getting a little dabble do you no more. We can't just be shouting and don't know what we're shouting about. John gives us a word that says that the thinking in God's mind.
Yes.
Y'all don't hear what I'm saying.
Yes.
God thought of some stuff in the beginning.
Yes.
That just went over y'all head.
Yes.
He said in the beginning.
Yes.
Was the word.
Yes.
In the beginning.
Yes.
Was logos.
Yes.
Can I help you teach this thing?
Yes.
In the beginning.
Yes.
Was God's mind.
Yes.
He was putting stuff together.
Yes.
In the beginning.
Yes.
Was the word. In the beginning,
yes.
God was fashioning
yes.
your future.
Yes.
He was fashioning what you needed
yes.
before you even knew it for yourself.
Yes.
That's why Jeremiah tells us
yes.
that John said, and he said that before you was in your mother's womb, Jeremiah,
yes.
I knew thee.
Yes.
I thought about thee.
Yes.
I thought about your prophecy.
Yes.
I thought about what we needed.
Yes.
Is there anybody here that believe that the word thought about you in the beginning before the universe was even created? I wish I had some folk that knew that God thought about you when you didn't think about yourself. Good God Almighty, I wish I had somebody that knew God thought about your situation when you couldn't do it for yourself. But it started in the beginning. It started in the beginning. Somebody say yeah. But how many of you know that the enemy will try to discredit the word? The enemy Slewfoot, Beelzebub, Satan, that man you used to date a long time ago, y'all gonna help me. The enemy will try to discredit your worship. But not only will it come after your worship, but he'll try to make you doubt the beginning.
Yes.
Y'all didn't even catch that.
Yes.
Let me take you back to the beginning.
Yes.
When Eve
yes.
was in the garden.
Yes.
God had given a word to Adam.
Yes, yes.
Can I take you back to the garden?
Yes. Come on.
He gave Adam a word
uh-huh.
in the beginning.
Yes.
And he said, don't eat
uh-huh.
the forbidden fruit.
Uh-huh.
And if you go back to Genesis 3, verse 3 through 4, Eve even tells the serpent,
yes.
God said,
yes.
don't eat
yes.
the forbidden fruit.
Yes.
Isn't that what it said?
Yes.
But somehow, the enemy
yes.
will try to get you
yes.
to doubt what God said.
Yes.
He said,
yes.
you shall not surely die.
Uh-huh.
Next thing you know,
yes.
Eve is eating the fruit,
yes.
and so is Adam. All because we doubted
yes.
what God said in the beginning.
Yes.
And I stopped by to tell somebody this morning, it doesn't matter what the enemy says, you got to go back to the beginning.
Yes.
You got to go back to what he told you,
yes.
what he said in his word,
yes.
not how you feel, not about your hunger, not about your thirst, not about your debt. I wish I had some help this morning.
Yes.
Not about your lust, but what God said in his word.
Yes.
Said it in the beginning.
Yeah.
Touch somebody, say in the beginning.
Yeah.
What's the word?
Yeah.
In the beginning.
Yeah.
What's the word?
Yeah.
John lets us know we need to start just like he did.
Yeah.
But we got to start out
yeah.
like we hold out.
That's right.
We got to start out
yeah.
like we hold out, Deacon.
Yeah.
We got to start out
yeah.
with the word.
Yeah.
Because in the beginning,
yeah.
was the word
yes.
and the word was God
yes.
But let me go ahead and finish the rest of verse 1 and I'll go ahead and take my seat. It said, and the word was with God
yes.
and the word was God
yes.
Can I give you this and then we'll get on out of here
yes.
Start thinking like Jesus
yes.
Start thinking
yes.
like Jesus
yes.
John gives us a glimpse of the connection and the power that he had with God's word
yes.
when he was connecting with the triune God.
Yes.
Do I have a witness this morning?
Yes.
John shows us how Jesus
mm-hmm.
was there in the beginning with God the Father and the Holy Spirit. But in order for John's perspective to be truly understood, we have to go back to the beginning. Genesis 1 and 3 gives us an indication of God's power, Minister Johnson. And thinking about how we can benefit from that power that was there in the beginning. Genesis 1 and 3 said, and God said, let there be light. And there was light. Do I have a witness this morning? We can see the power of God's words, Deacon, and the ability to create something out of nothing. Let me say that again. God's words has the ability to create something out of nothing. He uses, though, the Hebrew word haya. The Hebrew word in the Old Testament said, let there be. In other words, when you go down to Genesis, you find that he said, let there be light. God uses the logos that we find in John 1 and 1. And he thinks about the light before he created it. Some of y'all didn't get that. Because if we go back to chapter 1, verse 2, the earth was formed and without void. There was all kind of chaos in his creation. There was all kind of mess going on in the situation. Can I bring it to today's time? That's why in some of our homes, our children are acting up. Because we got chaos in the home, but we don't have any light. Oh, I wish I had some help this morning. We got chaos on the job. God has given us a job, but we ain't got any light on the job. That's why the boss man got you ready to cuss him out when you see him. Because he got chaos on your job. But I like what God does with the logos when he takes us down and he says, let there be light. And there was light. But can I give you a little extra? If we jump on down to John 1 and 1, that light was Jesus Christ, because he sent him 40 and 4 generations, all the way from the beginning, all the way to John 1 and 1. And he said the Word was God, and the Word was with God. He was with God when the earth was formed without void. He was with God when there was chaos in the water. He was with God when you got situations in your home. He was with God when you're about to lose your mind. But I wish I had about two or three people that the same God that was there in the beginning is in here right now. The light is on right now, and the same light that was in verse 3 is the same light right now. Do I have anybody in the building that know that in the beginning it showed up right here? The beginning, it showed up right here. Somebody say yeah. We got to start out with the Word. We can't start out without feelings. We can't start out without titles. We can't start out because your first name is Reverend and your last name is Doctor. Y'all want to help me? Because you got some folk out there, the only thing they want you to know is their title. The only thing they want to know is that you're Deacon General, Reverend Smith, Deaconess Bay, Trustee so-and-so, Mother so-and-so. Even if you put toilet tissue in the bathroom, they want you to know you do that too. But I stop by to tell you, you got to start with the Word. You got to start with the Word. You got to start with the Word, because that Word is living water. We get ready to go home. That same Word was flowing like water some 2,000 years ago. Somebody can get on their feet right now. I can see that water running down an old hill. I can see that water running down the hill. They call it Golgotha's Hill. But I can see the Word. It was running down that old rugged cross. I can see the Word, that living Word that washed me white as snow. Somebody living water.
Yes.
It's called the blood.
Yes.
The blood of the Lamb.
Yes.
And it came running down.
Yes.
It came washing me.
Yes.
It came washing me.
Yes.
In the same water.
Yes.
That we saw in the beginning.
Yes.
It's running right now.
Yes.
And it ran down Jesus.
Yes.
It ran down the cross.
Yes.
Do I have anybody here?
Yes.
It's still running like it did,
yes.
But you got to start out.
Yes.
You got to start out,
yes,
with the word.
Yes.
Did anybody know the word?
Yes.
Did anybody know the word? Somebody say yeah.
Yes.
The doors of the church.
All right.
Doors of the church open.